Hi everyone, and welcome to this podcast session. I'm Emeline, and you may remember me from Off the Grid in Gabon, Ethiopia, and of course in Finland. Now I'm a presenter, producer, and I also do some journalism for the BBC, so you may have seen me on one of my many reports on there. But today I am so excited because we have an amazing travel YouTuber, Sabina Trojanova. Please introduce yourself for our amazing audience.
Hi, thanks so much for having me. So I'm Sabina, and like you said, I run a travel YouTube channel. I also have other social media and a blog, but the YouTube is where I'm kind of focusing most of my energy right now. And it's about travel, obviously, but the ethos is kind of introducing other people's stories and sharing their experiences and their culture.
Sounds so fascinating. Actually, I have like so many questions about what you're doing right now involving a sacred month, because I'm based in Dakar at the moment. So it's like super, I mean, it's what's happening right now. So it'd be great to get your input on that. But where are you at the moment? And then like, what's your quarantine experience? What is it like?
Right. So at the moment I'm in South London. I moved back here in the summer of 2019. And to be honest, in the UK, I think because all the, you know, all the things were introduced a bit late, currently there's not that much happening out and about, which is a good thing because we all need to be staying home. Mm-hmm. But my experience personally hasn't been too bad because I'm very fortunate to live with three of my friends. So it's been a pretty fun lockdown, or I mean, as fun as it can get, really. We've been trying to make the most of the situation and just, you know, feeling pretty blessed because a lot of people are, you know, on the front lines and really struggling.
What kind of things are you getting up to?
So we've been trying to really amp up our social calendar. So we're doing things like taskmaster challenges in the house. We're having cook-offs. We're trying to, you know, learn new skills. I've been trying to learn Spanish for the past 30 days and getting outdoors a tiny bit to do exercise, which normally I wouldn't even do. Like, a lot of people are like, oh, I can't believe they closed down my gym. This changes everything. I'm like, yeah, I had a membership. I never went in. But suddenly, now that I can't, I'm like, okay, I guess I'll do exercise.
Yeah, I think that's been like a really interesting thing to see worldwide is everybody doing like at-home workouts. And I was the first person to say, I am not doing a home workout. I'm going to go to my studio. And there's me like, I, you know, looking on Instagram, who's doing a live, you know, yoga video and who's doing, you know, any sessions. And it's been great in a way because I'm also connecting to my old yoga teacher that was in London. From way back in 2015, 2016. So it's been really interesting to see how everybody's kind of like coming together, you know? But talking, you know,
for
getting
sure
back to travel, how did you get into it? And then how did you plan it?
Okay, so my first taste of travel, I got back when I was 2 years old. I'm very fortunate that my parents prioritized travel a lot. In fact, no, I was 1.5.
What?
My first international trip. So I'm very, very fortunate in that sense that travel is something I've always done, but I definitely did amp it up later.
Where did you go?
We first traveled to Spain. We went to Mallorca. And
amazing.
Yeah, it kind of grew from there. I'm actually working on this video where I'm trying to list all the countries I've been to. I'm doing one of those scratch up maps right now. And I realized I visited 18 countries before I turned 18. So that's incredible.
Wow.
That, you know, I'm so fortunate. Yeah.
That's amazing. So then when you decided that, you know, I've gone to all these different countries and now I want to make it my career, how did you kind of plan? Did you save lots of money or, you know, what was your strategy?
Right. So the way my journey started is it started when I was at uni and I was doing my year abroad in Russia. I was in Moscow for a year and I thought, oh, this is kind of interesting. Maybe people would be interested to like learn more about what life is like over there because it seems to be this great unknown, even though it's, you know, one of the world's biggest countries. So I started putting stories out there. And by the way, I was so naive at this point. I was like 19 years old and I thought, why is nobody running these travel blogs? I mean, it's such a good idea. How am I the first person to have thought of this? Which I very much wasn't. I mean, they were a dime a dozen at that point already, but I just never come across one. So I was like, Miss Original over here, you know, really pleasing myself.
I started it. Yeah.
Yeah, I thought, oh, what a genius. When you're 19, you know, these kind of things just seem natural. So I started writing about my time in Russia. And then a few months later, this was at the beginning of 2014. And then a few months later, I got the opportunity to go to China with a program called Study China, which is sponsored by the UK government. And I thought, okay, this is cool. Things are picking up. So I started, you know, including more destinations. I went to Morocco with my friend as well. And that summer, blessing in disguise, silver lining, kind of topical in these times, I got pretty sick with a lung infection. I wasn't hospitalized or anything, but I was stuck at home and I had zero energy to like leave the house. So I thought, okay, what am I going to spend my time on? And I thought, do you know what? I'm going to work on this blog because that seems like a fun thing to do. And I did that. And a few months later, it kind of came together pretty fast. I started getting offers of like sponsorship and press trips. And I was like, whoa, hold on a second. What is this? Because yeah, when I started the blog, remember, I thought I was the first travel blogger in the world. So I didn't know that you could make money of it, obviously, because, you know, I thought it was trailblazing. Oh. So then when I realized that, I was like, oh, this is really interesting. And I was still in my final year of uni, so I wasn't able to do quite as much traveling as I maybe would have wanted to at that point. Then when I graduated, I thought, I could use my degree and, you know, get a job. And I did a degree in political science, so I could kind of get a job in that sector. Or would it be more fun possibly to travel the world and get paid to do it? So
I wonder.
Took it from there. Yeah. So a decision was made.
That's so interesting. So it's really fascinating actually that you just kind of did it because you loved it and you wanted to share your travels. And you weren't specifically thinking, I can make a career out of it. So when everybody started coming to you for sponsorship deals, you must have been like, oh, this is interesting. So what do you think you'd have done?
Like, what planet am I on?
Yeah, what do you think you would have done if you hadn't done that?
Well, I think my life still would have revolved around travel in some capacity because my idea was to either go into journalism or to get a job working for the EU or one of those bigger kind of transnational organizations. So I think either way, travel would have sneaked its way into my life. But yeah, I don't think it would have been quite as freeing an experience. And, you know, becoming an entrepreneur essentially at the age of however old I was, 20 or 21, it taught me a lot. It's a kind of a crash course in adulthood. Although there are definitely aspects that, you know, kind of slipped by and I had to pick up later. But yeah.
But that's pretty good. So you've kind of, how many languages do you speak now?
This is one of my favorite questions because languages are a huge hobby of mine. And the way I learned them is usually by living in that country, which made it much easier. So currently I speak Czech, which is my mother tongue. I speak English. When I was 13, my family moved to Austria. So I speak German. I learned French in high school, although French is definitely not as good as the other three, the three I'm fluent in. I speak Russian as well because I did my year abroad there. And I also had some friends from Russia and my first boyfriend was Russian. So I got to practice a bit. Wow. And right now I'm trying to learn two more. My skills are pretty basic in both, but the two are Spanish and Arabic. I'm currently doing a 30-day Spanish challenge actually, which has been really fun. I'm trying to see how fluent I can become, but we have about 10 days left and let's see.
I'm going to have to just hop over to a Spanish-speaking country as soon as I can and just, you know, rush
as soon as I can, yeah.
Yeah, I can imagine. So, you know, we see a lot of the fancier side to traveling and all of the nice places you get to go, but we're not always very privy to maybe some of the struggles or some of the obstacles. Can you, like, share some of those that you've had along the way on your journey?
For sure. And I love this question because putting that question to myself is what actually drove me away from social media for an entire year. I kind of quit cold turkey back in 2018 because I looked at my Instagram and I realized that I had become, I hate to put it like that, but you know, one of those people who portray a very unrealistic image of what travel is really like. You know, there I was, stood on a mountaintop in a beautiful flowing dress. And, you know, here's me on the beach looking like I'm having the time of my life, which I'm sure I was at the time, but that wasn't the entirety of my existence. You know, I'm as human as anyone and I make tons of mistakes and, you know, there are tons of unpleasant things that I have to deal with in life. And questioning myself on that front led me to take a huge step back. So I actually quit all my social media for over a year. And I only came back to it at the beginning of this year, 2020, which, as it turns out, was maybe not the best timing, but here I am.
Wow. So when you stopped all of your social media, what did you do work-wise? Did you keep up to only your YouTube, or how did you make that work?
So I quit everything. I didn't even touch it for over a year. So YouTube, non-existent, Instagram. I didn't like delete any of the accounts, wow, but I wasn't putting up anything new. What I did instead is I decided to go back to my roots. I thought, okay, well, I have this fancy degree in political science and global development. Like, what am I going to do with it? Let's try and see if I can apply that knowledge. So initially, I still had, you know, a fair bit saved up. So I decided to go volunteering, because I thought, you know, let me take a step back and try and figure out what I want to do. So I went to Northern Greece and I volunteered in a refugee camp, which was honestly the best experience that I've had in my entire life. Obviously, you know, there's horrible things that happen on the ground, but it's also so enriching, you know, in terms of getting a bit of perspective, realizing that maybe your problems aren't all that bad. And also generally just meeting incredible people who inspire you with their resilience. So that was an incredible experience, and I came away from it with loads of ideas in my head, but not much clarity. So I thought, okay, let's take some time and try and apply for loads of different jobs in this, you know, nonprofit sector and see what comes back. And as I was doing that, one job suddenly like really stood out, and it was working for this cool, innovative homelessness organization in London. Because I didn't even care where in the world I would live, but I thought, okay, London would be logical because I lived there before. And luckily, after I think it was 5 or 6 rounds of interview, they accepted me. So I took the job, and it was a great decision because I learned so much through working there as a marketing manager, you know, wow, a bit of structure in my life as well for the first time, I think, in 5 years. So it gave me a lot. So that's what I did while I was away on my little break.
That's fascinating. So you literally stepped away from the travel industry, and then would you say that you've come back into that now, or how are you feeling about it?
Yeah, so I, as you'll kind of spot throughout this interview, I don't always have the best timing. In fact, my timing is always, or often, hilariously bad. So about a month before all this lockdown stuff unfolded, I quit my job.
No!
I quit my job. And I thought, this is fantastic. I booked my flights to Southeast Asia. I thought, this is going to be my year of travel. So that's fun.
Oh, no. Yeah.
Honestly, I think it's a good thing that it happened, because it was the right time for me to move on. Mm-hmm. And I can still, you know, create new YouTube content and stuff like that. Obviously, I can't travel, but I still count myself so as, you know, one of the lucky ones.
Okay, so that's good. So you're fine. How do you think that this, you know, this whole situation of coronavirus is going to impact, you know, the industry and the travel industry in the long term? And then how do you think that's going to impact the way you travel?
I've seen a lot of travel bloggers kind of trying to, you know, guess at what's going to happen and having all these debates about it. But personally, I feel like we just can't, you know, answer that question at this point. I feel like it would be kind of irresponsible of me to like publicly, you know, say, oh, I think such and such is going to happen. But what my hope is, and this sadly may not be what happens, but my hope is that people come away from this experience with a bit more perspective. They come away from this, you know, looking out for their community a bit more, they come away from this more eager to get to know other people around them, to emphasize that cultural and community aspect of travel. Whether that's going to happen is anybody's guess. And I think quite often I can be a bit, you know, too optimistic. But I have seen so much kindness in the world lately, and people really kind of stepping out their comfort zone in a very different way. You know, meeting their neighbors, which sadly has become a thing that's outside of most people's comfort zones, and helping, you know, that person down the street because they know that they're vulnerable, might be struggling. So my hope is that when people go back to traveling, maybe they're eager to get out of that all-inclusive hotel and instead go, you know, meet the locals and have more conversations. That's how I've always loved to travel, but I would love to see more people doing that.
Yeah, it feels like it's going to become a lot more, I guess, local. And, you know, people are not going to want to, I mean, luxury is great and it's good, but I think everyone is kind of more conscious that the most important thing, I guess, is people and the community and how you kind of connect with those people as well whilst you're traveling. What has been some of your favorite places to travel and why?
Ooh, this is one of those questions that you always know you're going to get, but I never have a good answer for it, because I feel like the way you enjoy a destination depends on so many factors, right? It depends on your state of mind, who you're going with, it depends on the season and on the, you know, say political situation in that country at the time, it depends on who you meet, it depends on so many factors. But with all that said, I do obviously have a few favorites that I would love to return to. I usually name one country in particular, and I'm going to name the same one today. That country is Malawi. Went there for a few weeks and I ended up staying 2 months. I loved it. Yeah, it's amazing. A beautiful country. Have you ever been?
I've not been to Malawi, not yet, but it's high on my list.
Not yet. Amazing, yeah. As it should be, because this country, it doesn't have access to the sea, but it has this ginormous lake that runs, you know, across the entire country. And when you're on the beach, you feel like you're on any beach. It's beautiful. The water is calm. But most importantly, just the people. And I know this can be said of any country in the world, but everyone that I met during my time there was just so kind, so friendly, and kind of happy to take me under their wing and introduce me to other people, which, yeah, for me is always the highlight. So Malawi, very kind of undiscovered by most. So
yeah,
a good time.
Would you go back
when it's possible?
Yeah,
100%. Yeah, there, I'm currently speaking with one of my friends about maybe hosting a group trip to Malawi, but obviously the timelines have been a bit skewed. So
like shifted. Yeah, completely. I think that's the thing. It's kind of tricky. Like, are you planning anything? Like, or are you just literally leaving it open now to find out what's going to happen?
I'm leaving it open at the moment. I'm definitely daydreaming a lot and I'm watching a lot of YouTubers' videos. And I also checked out, you know, Travelxp stuff because it's important to do a bit of, I don't know, you know, armchair travel and to see what else is out there, because there's still so many countries that I've not been to. But equally, I'm trying to take it easy. And what I've been really trying to focus on is pinpointing why I travel and trying to see how I can take that ethos or that reasoning and apply it to my life here in London, which isn't always easy because, you know, sometimes you just travel to explore other cultures and it's not that easy to do from the, you know, confines of your home. But equally, there's so much that you can do no matter what the reason is behind you traveling from, you know, from literally just the four walls that you occupy.
Yeah. Is there anything that you miss whilst you're in lockdown?
I just really miss meeting people. Like, I'm that weirdo on the bus that smiles at everyone. Okay. Just to like paint a picture. So I really crave human contact. And every time I go to the shop, I try to like chat to the shopkeeper, but sometimes they're a bit like, lady, move on. Weird. And I'm like, yeah, I know, but just.
Especially London. Especially London. London is just like, no. Everyone goes about
although,
their business.
I will, yeah. I will say where I live. I live in Peckham. Yeah. And Peckham is a bit of a microcosm and people are very friendly here. So yeah. I am a weirdo, but I'm one of quite a few.
When I lived in London, I lived in Southeast London. So I was literally about 20 minutes from Peckham Drive. I was in Lewisham.
Nice. I love this. Lewisham. Oh, I love this area. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. If I was to go back, it would definitely be like Southeast, Southwest, like that whole kind of area, 100%. Yeah.
Yeah, because what makes it brilliant as well from a travel perspective is just how diverse this area is. There are people from all over the world, and I love that. I literally walked down the road, and there are so many like outdoor markets, even now, and I can pick up ingredients that, you know, you wouldn't find in most bars. I can, you know, pick up a bag of plantains and, you know, spices that I'd never even heard of, Afghan food, like you name it.
Yeah. There's just so many cultures. It's like a, like, it's like a melting pot of cultures. I think that's why I loved it as well. I wanted to ask you a little bit about actually how that's been for you. And then also the way that it's kind of uniting people around the world is how, you know, it's important to kind of unite within the travel industry. So first, your, you know, experience, how's that been like?
It was incredible. It wasn't my first experience with Ramadan. I tried it for a few days last year while I was in Indonesia. But ironically, even though Indonesia is the country with the biggest Muslim population, I was on a Hindu island. So it's just something I really wanted to do, and it wasn't necessarily related to where I was at the time. But this year I thought, okay, I have all this time on my hands. I should just really embrace it and try and, you know, tap into, yes, obviously the fasting aspect, but also the spiritual side of it and try and learn a bit more, because I have been interested in learning more about religion, whether it's Islam or other faiths, for quite a while now. It's something I wasn't exposed to growing up. So I thought, okay, I've got catching up to do, you know, let's do it now. The experience has been wonderful. You may have noticed me taking a sip of water, so I am drinking now.
Okay.
Yeah. But I would 100%, you know, do this again in coming years. I think it's not only kind of taught me that my willpower is stronger than I thought it was, but it's also brought me so much closer to a lot of my Muslim friends and followers, because now I can really empathize with what they go through every single year. And yeah, it's been a brilliant experience. I have learned a lot, and I'm still continuing to learn.
Yeah, empathy, I feel like at the moment, is just so important. And, you know, a lot of the time, sometimes it feels like maybe on social media or, you know, kind of in different industries, there's this competitiveness. But I feel what's been great is kind of seeing people stick together actually within the travel industry. And especially now, like, how important do you think it is for everyone to be solidaire? Like, I was going to say solidaire in French.
No, so that's good.
I speak French every day, so I sometimes like go in and out, you know, like to have that solidarity between themselves.
I think solidarity is incredibly important. And for me, it's the main takeaway that I would hope people get out of traveling in general, because when you're traveling, a lot of the time in, you know, countries that you may not speak the language of, you will be relying on the kindness of strangers. And you might be quite reliant on them for a fair few things, you know, whether that's your food or your accommodation or even, you know, your transport. Some people hitchhike around the world. And I think seeing that people are kind everywhere, because they are, spoiler alert, like, you don't need to travel the world to learn that. That's a fact, which is incredible and very encouraging. You know, you will learn that that solidarity exists across borders and across cultures. And for me, I've really taken that lesson and tried to apply it to my own life, so I can be, you know, a bit more helpful and, I don't know, forthcoming when people approach me. So yeah, solidarity for the win. I think that's the biggest value.
And are you connecting with like other travel bloggers at the moment?
Yeah, lots. I think right now, you know, is a very strange and difficult time for a lot of my colleagues. So we have been coming together a lot and, you know, having Zoom calls or WhatsApp chats and, you know, just trying to support each other through this, because a lot of people have lost their livelihoods that they've spent years and years building. I still think, you know, I've come out of this quite well, even though I did quit my job at a very strange time. But, you know, I still feel very blessed, and I still have money coming in from, you know, various sources. And that's not the case for a lot of people. But I think, you know, these chats, A, bring us together, but B, are also also teaching us a lot about how to go forward in the travel industry and how to maybe change for the better, how to diversify our income, how to become a bit, you know, more stable in the way that we earn, and hopefully a bit more empathetic in the way that we live our lives.
Yeah, I think that's beautiful. So that's definitely been kind of, I guess, the message from COVID. And to kind of end it, I guess, on that point, what does traveling represent for you, like on a global sense for yourself?
I think travel just has the unique power to teach people a lot about others, but also about themselves by extension. Because when you see how other people live, you immediately have to compare and contrast the way that you live. Mm-hmm. And in doing so, I think we are able to improve ourselves in so many ways, because, you know, you might travel to Dakar and you pick up this one thing that people do over there and you're like, this is incredible, I'm going to incorporate that into my daily life. You know, you fast for Ramadan and you learn so much about your willpower. You learn a bit about this incredible dish in South America and you're like, I'm going to cook it and introduce my friends to it. It can be very little things, you know, like cooking a new meal. It can be major things like learning about a new faith. You know, it can be all manner of things, but if you take them and adopt them in your everyday life, I think you're doing this beautiful thing of bringing cultures together, becoming more empathetic, becoming more open-minded, and I think people will see that and hopefully be inspired by it. So I think, you know, traveling can only improve a person. Although, having said that, it depends on how you travel, and, you know, you can learn all these things by traveling locally and by, you know, talking to people in your community. So for me, really, it's more about human connection than it is about going across different borders.
Yeah, I think that's beautiful. I think for my travels, that's what I've kind of seen, is that if there's anything, is that everyone is kind of very similar, and then there's definitely, you know, some key just some key values that most people have, you know, to be loved, to respect, and those kind of go across wherever you go in the world.
For although,
sure. Next up, we are gonna play a game.
Okay.
Let me write. Where we have a sentence. And I'm gonna time it because I think we might, let me get my phone. I'm gonna time it because I feel like otherwise we may end up spending quite a while on this, because these sentences are not very easy, but I'm sure you're gonna get it. I can have a very good feeling. So it's a lip reading, and let me get my clock. Okay, so do you want me to go first? I think I should go first. So you're going to have 60 seconds to guess this sentence that I have. Okay. Are you ready? Countdown. Starting. 59 seconds. We are going. Okay.
I wear. Where am I? I lost. My book. I'm lost. Money. I lost my wallet. No, book. I lost my book. I book. Wallet. I lost my wallet. Where? Hot. Eat.
Oh no.
I lost my wallet. Give me food.
Okay, the time has gone off. So I lost my wallet in Chile.
Oh, in Chile! I could have got Chile. That's embarrassing.
Don't worry. So I think what we'll explain is that in the sentence, I mean, the ones that I've got, it's often something, something, you know, and then there's a country at the end.
Yeah. That's so remember for me as well.
Okay. Do you want to go next?
Yes.
I'm going to put
Okay, I'm going to try a different method. I'm going to try just like enunciate.
Yeah, because I think it's supposed to be lip reading, but I don't know. I just started doing, yeah, okay.
Charades are fun.
Charades okay. are lovely. How is the Whether in London? In Nepal. It's a country. Indonesia. Gap. Camp.
They look the same.
Camp. Cambodia. Cambodia. Oh, yes. Oh, my God.
That was good.
So you know what? I think lip reading is just as hard as charades. So the next one, I am going to do lip reading as well. Okay.
Okay, let's try it.
So.
My hands are sweaty. This is stressful.
And we've only done one each. Okay. I know. Right. Next one. And we have like 2 minutes. 1 minute, okay, because we have to wrap up. Right. Okay, so.
I have 8 a how tent.
Okay.
I have a flight. You two. Two. I have a flight to Turkey.
Yes! You're kidding me.
No, that, I was like, that can only be a bird. I was like, what bird card is that? Okay, good. I feel like, okay, after that chili debacle, I needed a win. I really did.
Okay, so I really need to get your next one. Okay, I'm ready. Okay. I'm ready. I want, I would love to, ooh, what's that? Flight? I would love to.
Wait, okay, can I help a bit? I'm yes. gonna show you the second syllable.
Okay.
Of that word, yeah?
Perfect.
The second syllable.
Sit.
Mm-hmm.
Say again, let me see. Oh, you would like to find sit. I would fancy.
Not
I would
love
fancy. Oh my gosh. Okay, what's the next thing? Let me at least get the next okay. place.
And then it's the country, okay?
Okay.
Oh, God.
Say again. Poland. Okay. So I would love to visit.
Yes!
Yes! Okay, this is
okay,
great.
Okay, visit, yes.
Okay. So the next one is... I'm glad this is lip reading and not charades. Right.
My friends, yeah. From, my friend from.
Or, well, it's a plural. Mm-hmm. Okay.
My friends from.
Yeah.
Just in case I'm whispering, okay. Do it again.
Okay, so.
You.
Yeah.
Uzbekistan?
Oh. Yes! You're so good. Okay. You are amazing. Oh,
No, it's probably because you're good at explaining that them and I'm terrible. So I'm like, oh yeah, that was perfect. And then I'm just like, and they just keep sitting down and you're like, what is going on? Okay.
Well, okay, your last one
on my list.
Yeah.
Oof.
Let's. Yeah. Let's travel. Let's fly. Let's chill. Let's relax. Let's relax. Chill. Let's chill.
No, chill.
Chill. I so said that. In. Let's chill in. Yeah.
And now the country.
Right.
Okay.
My lord. Okay. So it's three different things, right? Okay.
Yeah, it's three different things. Okay. First one.
Yeah. I'm seeing bambua.
Okay, kind of.
Ut.
I'm gonna speak. For the last word, there's an animal.
Right.
And it's that word. And then it's
guinea pig. Okay, so let's chill in something Guinea. Papua New Guinea.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Congratulations.
I feel like we cheated a tiny bit with the directions, but I feel like we had to.
That was good. I was like, yeah, Papua New Guinea. Let's chill in Papua New Guinea.
Very good.
I would love
love to go there.
That'd be amazing.
Me too. When this is over, let's go chill in Papua New Guinea, please.
Please, that'd be amazing. So, Sabina, before we, you know, part ways and go on about our days today, do you have any kind of last words that you'd like to share?
Well, first of all, thank you all so much for watching. I really appreciate it. And if you enjoyed what I had to say and you'd like to see more of me on the internet, you can find me at Girl VS Globe on YouTube and Instagram and other social media. And I also have a website, but I'm guessing they'll be linked somewhere below, so you don't have to type it in. And I mentioned this very briefly before, but I have recently written my first book, which I'm really excited about. It's a book with 500 different destinations to visit, and it's mainly targeted at millennials. And even though right now we can't, we will be able to soon. The book hasn't come out yet. It's set to come out in November. It might change a bit, so your best bet is following me on social media, and I'll definitely be letting everybody know.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for your time, Sabina. You've been amazing. I'm sure our audience have also been able to learn so much more about you. And we can't wait to see what you're going to do, where you're going to go next. And if everybody wants to follow Sabina, make sure that you follow her on her social media, and then you can know where she'll be going next. And then just finding out what she's getting up to right now is really exciting and interesting. So thank you so much. I'm Emeline, and we'll see you very soon. Bye.
Thanks, Emeline. Bye.